Hello everyone. Now, today I am taking spherical lenses as an example of refraction. Spherical lens is a transparent material bounded by two surfaces, one of which are spherical. Now, what do you mean by this line? We mean that if you have, suppose you have this kind of circle or a sphere and you cut the parts here, you can have either a combination of two spherical sides, means like this is given. Here, this is given. Now, if you want to change its shape, you can have one spherical side and another plane side. That will become plano-convex lens. Same way, if you just have this kind of combination, you can have plano-concave shape. If you have both the parts together, then we can have a combination of concavo-convex. So, in this way, you can have different varieties. But in your syllabus, spherical lenses are of two main types, convex and concave lenses, which are known as double convex and double concave. So you can see convex lens. In convex lens, this part in the middle is thicker and the edges are thinner. And if you look at this, this is thinner in the middle and thicker at the edges. So when you define it, you will write it is thicker in the middle, thinner at the edges, and rays of light, if they come parallel to it like this and they are converged on a focus point. So you can see that convex lens is a converging lens because all the rays are coming on a single point. But if you look at this, it's a diverging lens. When the rays are coming parallel, they are diverged. So they are not meeting on this side. They are meeting virtually on this, on the left side. Here it is the right side. Here it is the left side. Now, here you can see that both of them are having just opposite nature of each. Now, as we have finished this, we come to the refraction by spherical lenses and the rules. Rule number one, if a ray passes through the lens and is coming parallel to the principal axis, then it passes through focus. So when you draw the diagram of a lens, you have to show both the sides F1 to F1, which is C1, actually center of curvature from where the mirror, this lens is a part. Here it is C2. Same here, you can write it as C2, C1. So first of all, you have to just write all the parts in it. You can see here it's an optical center. Here is a point F1 where all the rays either actually meet or appear to meet. And you have double focus, means both the sides are having F1 and F2 foci. Now, if you can see this, why they have double focus? Because they are having two different spherical edges on this side as well as this side. This side as well as this side. Now, if you see this, directly you are coming and it is not diverging here. It is converging. But if you look at this lens, the rays diverge and it is coming virtually on this. So this is your rule number one. Then we come to rule number two. If the ray is coming from focus, it will become parallel like this. And reversal to this, we have the ray coming towards focus, but as you know, it's a diverging nature. So where it will go? It will virtually come to focus, but it will bend and it will be parallel to the principal axis. The third rule, in a convex lens and a concave lens, now you can see if a ray passes through optical center, it gets totally no deviation, means it will not change the path and directly it passes from optical center undeviated. Now, by using all these three rules, images we can think about. Now, in a convex lens, we have again six cases. Now, again, you have to just label it like this only, like F1, F2, F2 on this side, 2 F2 on this side. And then we can start with the first case when object is at infinity. So, you can take that case when object is at infinity. The parallel rays are coming. Show it with the help of dotted lines on this side as well as, and all the rays will be shown with the dotted lines. just showing that it is infinite point and you can see the case of this kind of infinity case. You can see that parallel rays are coming and then the rays are being diverged. Now it's a concave lens, but if you are doing the part of concave lens, in place of that convex lens is there, then you can see this. It is being diverged. But now it is being converged because now you have changed the lens to convex. So this is the first case of a convex lens when the object is at infinity and the image is formed at the focus and you are getting all these rays focused to point F2. Now another case, you can see when the object is beyond 2F1. If you keep, so its first principal axis is there, you are keeping your object at beyond 2F2. Oh, sorry, it is 2F1. 2F2 is on this side. So you can see that when object is beyond 2F1, the ray is coming parallel to it, will pass through focus. The other ray is passing from optical center and you are getting the image here. And you can see the position. It is between F2 and 2F2 and you can see it is diminished, real, inverted, and it is between F2 and 2F2. The previous case, you can see that it is highly diminished, real and inverted. Like this, you have to write all the characteristics in the image formation. Then you come to third. In the third part, the object is at 2F1. Principal axis, your object is at 2F1. So guess where it will be formed. It is again the case of C. So it will be C1. You will get your image at C2. So you can see here, it's a parallel line, passes through F2, will pass through optical center and automatically they are meeting here and you are getting your image at 2F2. So you can get the same size of the object, real and inverted. So it's a special case where we are getting the same size. Now the next case, when the object is between 2F1 and F1, image is formed beyond 2F2. So now you start with the principal axis, keep your object between F1 and 2F1 and what you are getting, the parallel ray passes through focus from optical center, it passes like this and you are getting the image beyond 2F2. So you can see it is formed beyond 2F2, it is enlarged, real as well as inverted. Now we come to the fifth case. When object is at F1, the image is formed at infinity. So you can see that if you keep your object at F1, you will be getting parallel lines because when parallel line comes, it passes through focus and the other ray which is passing from optical center and you can see that they are parallel to one another which shows that it's going to infinity. So you are getting highly enlarged, real and inverted image. Now we come to the last case. This case is a case of magnifying lens where even for small microscopes we can use this kind of system. So when object is between F and O, you can see here, you can keep your object between this position only. You can keep your object like this. You are having a parallel line, will pass through focus, will go from optical center and you can see now they are diverged, they will not meet on this side. So you have to make them forced meeting. So they are being forced now towards the other side, that is the front of the lens side, and you are getting enlarged, virtual and erect image like this. So these are all six cases related to convex lens. Now I'm coming to the image formed by a concave lens, which I had shown you earlier also. So let us see once again. You have an object. Now the parallel rays are coming from the infinity point. They are being diverged. And where are they meeting? They are meeting on the virtual focus. So if an object is at infinity, you are getting highly diminished, virtual and erect image. When the object is between infinity and F1, the image is formed. So let us see where the object is kept. You can see the principal axis. You can keep the object anywhere between O and infinity. Means you will make an object like this. And the parallel ray will pass through. The lens end will be diverged. It will come to the focus virtually, and one ray will pass through the optical center like this, and automatically it's meeting, and you are getting a point here. On this you will get the image formation. So your same side is being used. It is diminished, virtual and erect. Now when you compare this structure, you can see everything is on the left hand side. You can see object on the left hand side. You can see focus on the left hand side. You can see the image on the left hand side. So everything is on negative. So all these things are negative. But for a convex lens, your focus point is always on the left hand side. So like that, in the convex lens, you are getting all the things on this side except the object. So if you compare it with the convex lens here, you can see that focus is used here as the positive side, and the image which is formed here is the left side. It's for virtual only, and all the real images are formed on this side. That means your focus and the real images will get you the positive sign by using the sign conventions. Now I'm coming to the next part. So we have finished here. Now sign conventions for the spherical lenses. So we are following the same sign conventions like the mirrors. The left side is negative, right side is positive. So if you are getting your image on the right side, you will be getting plus sign. If your focus used is on the right side, like in convex lens we are using the right side, you will get the positive focal length. That's why convex lens focal length is always positive and concave lens focal length is always negative. Sign convention for spherical lenses, they are starting from optical center. In the mirrors you are using pole, but here we are using the optical center. So all the distances will be measured from optical center. You have to take your object on the left hand side. Always this left side is negative, right side is positive. Height above the principal axis is positive and height downwards is always negative. So we are following all the steps of mirrors in this case, and whatever we are following, you can see here that only the differences of optical center. And now after doing the lenses, you must have seen that concave lens or concave mirror, both are having negative focal lengths, and convex lens as well as convex mirror is always having positive focal length. So always remember this. Now we come to the lens formula. Once again we are using V, U and F, and the difference between mirror formula and the lens formula is that you are having negative sign here. 1 upon V plus 1 upon U is equal to 1 upon F was the mirror formula, and we are using 1 upon V minus 1 upon U is equal to 1 upon F as the lens formula. Now if you come to the magnification, the same rules are there. M is equal to height of image upon HO, that is height of object, and this is equal to V upon U. In mirror formula it was negative, but in lens formula it is plus V by U. And same conclusions are there if M is greater than 1, smaller than 1 and equal to 1. If greater than 1, image size will be bigger. If less than 1, image size will be smaller. And if it is equal to 1, same. And if your M is plus, it will give you virtual and direct image. If M is equal to minus, negative is the sign, then you will write it as real and inverted image. Now we will come to the next topic. This is power of a lens. Power of a lens is the reciprocal of focal length. Now if you write the focal length reciprocal, you can write it in the formula also. Now actually if you look at the exact definition, it's a mathematical form. But if you write power, it is the ability for the convergence as well as ability of a lens to converge or diverge. So it is the ability of a lens for convergence as well as divergence. So you can write it as reciprocal of its focal length, and it can be written like this also. But if your focal length is not in meter, then this formula changes to 100 upon F, and F will be in centimeters. So you can write this formula changing to 100 upon F in centimeters. Now, if you have seen this SI unit of power, you can see that it's a diopter word. When you go to a doctor, he's giving you power generally in minus, because you are using the lens for a concave lens, and that will be minus. But like I am using it for plus. That means I am using it for hypermetropic eye. So in diopter, that power generally we don't say, but actually the unit for power is diopter. A diopter is a power of lens whose focal length is 1 meter. That means if I write 1 upon 1, then for 1 meter, the power will be 1 diopter. And if it is concave lens, then it is negative. If it is convex lens, then it will be positive. So you can see this, that power of a convex lens is positive and the power of concave lens is negative. Now, sometimes we need the combination of lenses. Now, for combination of lenses in different optical devices, we are using power as the algebraic sum of individual powers. Suppose we have a combination of two lenses and one is plus 2, another is minus 3. What we will do, if we have a combination, we will add them and then the answer is minus 1 diopter. Okay, that means your combination answer will be minus 1 diopter. So this will have the nature of a concave lens, not the convex lens, because now the combination sign is minus. If the combination sign is plus, then the combination will behave like a converging lens, and if your answer is minus, then it will behave like a diverging lens. Now, why we are using the addition of powers? This is used by opticians. When he is having eye testing, he puts several different combinations of corrective lenses and known powers are there, and he is trying that what will be suitable for your spectacle frame. You know, spectacles are there and there is a frame. On the frame, he is putting the lens. So he calculates the power of a lens by simple algebraic additions, and you will have the combination. Like for example, here he has taken 2 diopter and plus 0.25 diopter, and single lens power will be addition of this. It will be 2.25 diopter, as I have shown you here. So it was also diopter, it was also, and we had added both of them. Here also it is being added, but now the power is plus. Here it was minus, but here it is plus. That means the combination will behave like a convex lens having a power of 2.25 diopter, and by dividing it with 1, means reciprocal of this 2.25, you can get the focal length of your lens. Now, simple additive property of powers of lenses can be used to design. Now, you have to design so many things like camera, microscope, telescope. So, this kind of combination will be used to design camera, microscopes and telescopes. So, that's all. I think now you are clear about all the topics related to refraction, reflection. Okay, thank you. God bless.